everyone and welcome back. You're watching The Money Show on ET Now. Well, let's welcome on board Harshvardhan Roongta of Roongta Securities to talk to us about curating a post-crisis, I'll not use the word post-COVID, but a post-crisis investment portfolio. Harsh, thank you so much for taking our time today to join us on The Money Show. And yes, Harsh, I'll call it a post-crisis portfolio because yes, COVID is very much still on our heads. And let me also tell our viewers on that note to ensure they use all the proper precautions if they have to step out. But the worst effects that it had on the economy, on the markets, on money, etc., now largely seems to be behind us, mercifully. So at least the one bad part of it is behind us. Harsh, you know, how have you seen this crisis change individuals' investment patterns, behaviors, habits, strategies?
Well, Mudula, when it comes to investing, you know, the investors we notice have a very clear, peculiar pattern of behavior. Now, and this unfortunately continues over and over again. So if you look at, you know, the times when, you know, COVID had just come in and, you know, markets fell about 40 to 50%, we saw most of the investors, or rather many of the investors, panic, and there was a large-scale redemption in mutual funds, in their equity investment, you know, just out of sheer panic. And now when you see the markets have recovered all the losses that they had, and in fact it's slightly higher than the pre-COVID level, we see investors coming back in full steam into equities again. So in an ideal situation, it should have been the other way around, wherein when markets fall, you should come in, invest more, and when markets go up, you start actually selling. So, and this unfortunately is the behavior that you will see over and over since decades. It is not something new this time. So I think investors, it's about time now that investors understand that, you know, if you really want to make money in equities, you really don't have to do anything. So not doing anything is like kind of a mantra for making money in equities. Markets will go up and down. I mean, the situations will come, they will go. There will be calamities, there will be, you know, unrest politically, you know, and all those kind of financially, all those things are going to happen. If you're an SIP investor, there is no reason for you to stop your SIP. So anyway, so answering your question, there are some very specific patterns which we've been seeing over decades now. But I think investors should learn this lesson now at least and make sure that they don't panic and they don't redeem in just because of emotional reasons.
So it's not just this crisis, but whatever we have, all the crises that we have in the last decade, the investor attitude and the reaction to these crises have largely remained the same. So, just to talk about this one in particular, Harsh, do you think that individuals need to tweak their investment strategy? Because we are obviously in a bit of a more newer world. We have things like Bitcoin, GameStop, etc., that are catching everybody's attention. Nobody wants FOMO either. In fact, that's the reason why we see almost anything and everything having participation from retail investors. Do you think that, you know, a tweak in investment strategy is warranted? Because this is a new world that we are in.
So I partially agree with you that you need to keep updating yourself with what is happening in the economy. So I don't say that you pick something that, you know, your grandfather probably had picked, or the assets that they were investing into, and that's the short formula. So well, most certainly yes, those are good investments. But you must keep yourself updated with what's happening. Now, under the pretext of keeping yourself updated, does it mean that you need to participate in everything? Otherwise you'll have that FOMO kind of a feeling and you feel somebody else is making money and you are not. So I think you don't need to cross that line. So very simply put, I mean, just understand the product that you understand. If there is something that you don't know how it functions, example Bitcoin. So I have never ventured into personally myself into any form of even exploring investing into Bitcoin. One very simple reason is I don't understand it. Secondly, I believe if there is something your government does not recognize, or rather does not support, let's not do it. I mean, it's as simple as that. There are other avenues to make money as well. I mean, if you find your friend gambling and making money, doesn't mean that you have a FOMO and start getting into that. So very simply, you know, keep your investment philosophy simple. Look at tried-tested products which are well-regulated. Make sure that anything that you invest into, there is somebody overseeing the regulations of that particular product. So I think that puts you in the safer zone. You have products in the category which give you the least returns, as well as something that is very high in risk and high potential for it. So I don't think you should be falling under that FOMO category and just doing everything that everybody is doing.
All right. So yes, some have got into FOMO. Some have decided to go into direct share trading, but some have also been very much focused on safety, wealth preservation, been extremely conservative. How do you find the balance there? I mean, should you have maybe a separate amount kept aside for share trading if you want to maybe hone your skills over there or something? Is that the right approach then?
So, unfortunately, during the lockdown, I did interact with a couple of people, and everybody started getting into share trading because all of the markets were kind of closed, and stock market being active, people were sitting in their houses doing nothing. So they thought that trading into stocks was something that was that would keep them busy. But I don't think the approach is right. Most certainly not. I mean, you don't start trading into any commodity only because it is convenient. Why do people believe that trading into equities is easy? I mean, it is not. You don't start trading into agricultural commodities. You don't suddenly start buying chana and oil and, you don't trade into those, right? So why do you feel that you can trade into equities? Equities is also a very, very specific field which requires a lot of study. It is not something that you do in your time. So, having said that, now coming to the portfolio element. Now, we have seen certain set of investors who are very heavily invested only into equity or very heavily only into debt. So neither of those situations is ideal. We have seen markets fall 40-50%. I mean, that happened kind of overnight. I mean, it was not an announced or predetermined event. So for an investor, it's very important that you have a balance of both. So you need to be, need to have safety in your portfolio. At the same time, you need to take calibrated risk so that you can generate higher returns. You can't do either or. It has to be a combination of both. And this is essentially what is asset allocation. I mean, you have, a percentage allocated to equity and debt both. The objective being, the weighted average, so debt will give you, say, 6%, for example. Equities have a potential to give you about, say, 12-15% kind of return. So combination of both of this, a weighted average portfolio return should beat inflation comfortably. So if you generate a weighted average return of, say, 10-11%, I think you're doing reasonably well. And that's how you will create wealth. You cannot create wealth by just keeping money in only one asset class, either very safe or taking a lot of risk. So this combination has to be put well in place, and then the weighted average being higher than what the cost of living goes up by, which is inflation, you will actually create wealth.
Okay, that's interesting. So post a crisis, or maybe during a crisis, should investors then tweak their asset allocation? Or let's say if an investor has decided that, look, I'm investing for my retirement, which is 30 years later, so this crisis really shouldn't bother me in any manner. Or should that be the attitude then?
Well, when we talk about asset allocation, so we're saying, for example, a person says that he wants to invest 60% into equities and 40% into debt. If this is a percentage allocation, so you don't tweak your percentage allocation based on the crisis. Markets have come down, you say, no, I want to start investing 100% into equity or 80% into equity. No, that is not the idea. But what you definitely should do is rebalance your portfolio. Now, there's the difference between tweaking the percentage allocation and rebalancing. So we are saying you stick to 60-40, for example. But because equity markets have come down, the equity portfolio in rupee terms will be down right now. So you sell debt and buy more of equity so that the value-wise, it is 60-40. When markets go up, so equity valuations have gone up. So now you sell equity in rupee terms and increase your debt allocation so that the net effect is still 60-40. So you don't change the percentage. You change the amount, the value, so that the balancing, it's called rebalancing, and you come to 60-40 again. So this percentage allocations will not change based on the market condition. This percentage change, if at all if it has to happen, that will change based on circumstances. Your lifestyle, your income going up, your risk profile changing. So in case, now in this example again, considering everything remains, stable, markets are stable, and then you feel that I need to invest more in equity. So you will increase from 60% allocation to say 70 or 80%. But the underlying factor determining this allocation change is not market condition. It is changes in your own risk profile, or income levels, or risk, or your social responsibility. So don't change your allocation percentage. Change rebalance your portfolio to align with the valuation part. Now, if you're talking about a situation where the person is 30 years away from retirement, and looking to worry about market conditions, you continue with the allocation as it is. In fact, just rebalance it so that you have more of equity when markets fall. And when markets go up, you most certainly will need to sell some bit of equity and increase your allocation to debt. the 60-40 ratio is maintained.
Okay, so that essentially makes sense. If you've sat down with your financial advisor and decided that, okay, you're going to invest, you know, 60% in equities and then 30% in debt and maybe 10% in gold, keep that. You don't really need to change that, because that's what asset allocation is. You are divvying up your total investment corpus percentage-wise into different categories, into different asset classes like debt, equity, gold, real estate, whatever that may be. So that really does not change. What Harsh spoke about in the previous answer, that's essentially where, you know, you keep yourself abreast. The way your grandfather used to invest, of course, you can't have the same principle and methodology in today's day and age. So that's essentially the kind of tweaks in investment strategy that you need to bring about. Harsh, if I had to ask you that, what are the top 2-3 lessons on money management that all retail investors needed to learn and implement from the crisis, from the pandemic, the lockdown, which saw people losing their jobs as well, what would those be?
So if I will list down 3 major learnings and lessons, I mean, the first and most important, I've been emphasizing time and again, while we're chatting even now, is asset allocation. So imagine a situation, we were at just before COVID market crash. If a person had, you know, very, you know, sensibly put in his mind and decided that I will have, say, probably 40, 50, 60, 70, whatever percentage into equity and the rest into debt, market crash wouldn't have bothered him. So invariably, the people who panicked and who got emotional about all this were people who did not put in those, that kind of thought into asset allocation. So while deciding asset allocation, percentages, you have to be keeping a lot of things in mind. You know, you put in equities only that much money that you don't require. If you don't require money and market crash, how does it kind of affect you? So you have far more strength to hold on to that investment. So the first lesson is, please work on your asset allocation if you haven't done it now. You cannot be overboarding any one asset class. Be it debt or be it equity, you cannot be overboarding any one asset class, because it's not going to save you through. The second learning, the major learning again, is emergency fund. We do see a lot of people who are very well financially, sound also. It's not that they don't understand the financial world, but the emergency fund concept is still not in place. I mean, so you need to, this pandemic has taught this lesson to people. You may be well settled in your career, in your job, etc., but overnight things can go wrong. So emergency fund is for everybody. Even if you're a senior level employee or a junior level, entry level, make sure you have a decent emergency fund to your side. And the third and most important again is insurance. We have been speaking about insurance, Mubina, several times on this show in the past as well, when you highlighted the importance of life insurance and your health insurance. So, you may be healthy in your lifestyle, maybe eating well, you may be exercising, etc., but this pandemic affected even people who are very healthy. So, to think that a company insures me, you lost your job and then you're hospitalized, your company cover doesn't provide you that cover that you look at. So, health insurance and life insurance, again, a very, very important factor. If you don't have, buy. If you have, please go and review whether you have sufficient. And I think these 3 things are something that a must-do activity immediately now when you listen to me.
Okay, all right. Yes, we've spoken quite a bit about insurance. Mercifully, people have really seen, people have expressed their interests as well. Insurance companies as well have seen that. But having said that, in the beginning of 2021, once again, all of that interest has petered off. So ladies and gentlemen, an insurance is not just something that you look at when there's a health crisis. It is a permanent feature, amidst your entire financial plan. Okay, well, on that note, we'll throw open the floor for questions and queries. Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd like to ask Harsh Vardhan Roongta any question on your portfolio, on personal finance tricks that you'd like to learn from him, on any advice you'd like to seek, you can email us. Our email address is themoneyshow@etnow.tv. We are monitoring it right now, so shoot them in quickly before we run out of time. Well, our first question is from Manoj Shrini. Very interesting one, actually. He asks that the government is considering divestment of all PSUs. Is it a good idea to buy Bharat 22 ETF? So he's actually considering this tactical allocation of some money to Bharat 22 ETF, which is an ETF that puts money in these PSUs. And yes, he's right in pointing out that some of these PSUs have really been buzzing. I'm not sure if they are necessarily a part of the Bharat 22 ETF, like IOB, Bank of Maharashtra, New India Assurance, etc. But you know, the whole PSU theme has been garnering a lot of attention. ONGC, NTPC are a part of Bharat 22 ETF and they've been seeing solid action. What do you think of such, exploiting such opportunities? And also, what do you think of the Bharat 22 ETF? Is it a good way to play it or would you rather just directly invest in the shares?
Yes, you're right. So, let's understand this very, very clearly. Manoj is saying that there is a disinvestment going to happen, which has been announced by the government, and the PSUs are likely to benefit out of this. So, instead of picking stocks specifically, if you could put ONGC, for instance, you could put XYZ and companies that you believe are going to go into disinvestment, and then it likely go up. So, only in the two circumstances, I would recommend the Manoj to invest into this. One is, if you can specifically track which companies are going to go and get into disinvestment immediately over the next 6 months, 1 year, etc. And then you will correlate it to saying that these companies also form a part of Bharat 22, so let me get into investing into it. Or the second option would be that, you genuinely believe, which was your question as well, how is Bharat 22 as a product? So if you genuinely believe that you need to have this kind of a portfolio in your, stock portfolio in your investment basket, then you will invest into it. So what am I trying to drive at? I am trying to drive at a point that do not invest into Bharat 22 only if you believe that the disinvestment process is likely to benefit a few companies in this basket. So that wouldn't be the right approach. I mean, if you invest only if you believe that there are good companies to invest into, or you can track the disinvestment process and specifically identify and pinpoint saying that these companies will benefit and they are forming a part of the Bharat 22, which I don't think is possible for any retail investor to do. If I were you or if I were Manoj, I would have still gone ahead and invested into a diversified fund. Because the diversified fund manager is also doing tracking these events. And I believe they are in a better position to make decisions and find out which company is going to benefit specifically. And they can invest into that particular stock on my behalf in a diversified fund. So I think that would still be a better approach. Rather than trying to, monetize or trying to take the maximum benefit of the disinvestment process through Bharat 22. I don't think that's a very long shot. We're trying to, accumulate those benefits through Bharat 22. I don't think that will help much.
Alright, there are lots of stocks in the Bharat 22 ETF, and if you want to sort of make a play on this divestment story, then there are obviously a few companies that have been targeted for this. If you have the knowledge of that, or if you think that if you have some sort of conviction on any of these PSUs, you might as well directly bet on those. Okay, Mayank Shah writes into us saying, I have 390,000 in LNT Hybrid Equity Fund, 76,000 in Motilal Oswal Multicap 35 fund. I'm planning to transfer my investments in equal amounts for better returns to the following few funds for 7 years. He wants to know if what do you think of them, Harsh? So there's the Axis Focus 25 fund, Invesco India Contra, Canara Robeco Equity Diversified, and SBI Magnum Multicap. So he seems to be unhappy with what these two funds, existing funds, are doing, and now he wants to shift to the other four funds. Harsh, what do you think?
Yeah, so Mayank will certainly go about doing these switches. So I'm in agreement with him that he can do that switch. And he's also picked up four schemes. So I think four schemes for an investment of 466,000 is sufficient enough. I mean, the purpose of diversification is served. You don't really need to have more than four schemes. I just have a small suggestion. I mean, so he's got two flexi caps that he's already investing into now. So he's got an SBI Magnum Multicap and Canara Robeco Equity Diversified. He shortlisted these two, which are flexi-cap category. So within the flexi-cap, if he intends to stay in the flexi-cap, which is fine, which is nothing wrong in it, if he intends to stay in the flexi-cap category, then in place of SBI Magnum Multi-cap, which is now also a flexi-cap, he can choose a Parag Pare flexi-cap. So that is one change. If he's still further okay, and that is my personal suggestion to him, that he retains one flexi-cap, which is Canara Robeco Equity Diversified, a flexi-cap fund now. And instead of the other one, which is not the SBI, not the Parag Pare, he's been going for an index fund. which is an ICICI approved Sensex fund. So that will give him a dedicated large cap passively managed index into his portfolio. So he'll get a good balance of everything in his portfolio. That's my suggestion to him. And as I mentioned, 4 funds is fine. So if he takes what I'm saying, he will have access to this 25 and Invesco India Contra Fund, the Canara Robeco FlexiCap, the equity diversified that he's named it as, and the ICICI through Sensex fund. I think these 4 will give him a better balance in the portfolio.
All right. Okay. So just some chops and changes in the recommendations put forward by Mayank. But largely, the rest seems to be pretty okay. All right. I don't think we will take any more questions. So Harsh, we'll let you go on that note. Many thanks once again for joining us today on The Money Show and helping our viewers as well out with their questions. All right, well, we'll take a very short break on the show, and when we return in our Spend with TMS segment, we'll be talking about gold, prices of which have fallen to 46,000 rupees. The pre-COVID price was 42,000 rupees. So what should your investment strategy be? I mean, if you've not bought financial gold, is this the right time to cash up on that? We'll be back with those answers.